Today I'm going to talk about extreme imaging and beyond. That means going to talk about the unique types of imaging techniques and also their applications. First, I want to talk about ultrafast imaging. This is a picture from the Olympics London 2012 100 meter final. The winner is probably familiar to you. It's Usain Bolt, who won the gold medal with his record time, 9.66 second. So these people can run 100 meter within 10 seconds, pretty fast. So as you can see here, I guess it doesn't work. The second and third winners arrive at this line with only 40 millisecond time difference. That means you need 10 millisecond time resolution to see which guy is winning. So this 100 meter over 10 seconds corresponds to 100 millimeter over 10 milliseconds. So that's nearly impossible to determine with human eyes which guy is winning. So that speed corresponds to 100 micrometer over 10 microseconds. So if you reduce the field of view, even at the same speed, you need higher temporal resolution to see what's going on. So if you look at nature, there are lots of ultrafast events, from sports to microns, cavitation bubbles, phonons, attosecond lasers, and chemical reactions. So there are lots of opportunities for us to see what's going on the ultrafast timescale. So here's a little comparison between microscopy and high-speed imaging. I said analogy between microscopy and high-speed imaging. With human eyes, of course, we cannot see these small things. But with the help of the microscope, we can see things on the larger spatial scale, because the microscope magnifies the object in the spatial domain. Likewise, the high-speed camera magnifies the object in the temporal domain so that we can see fast things in slow motion. Here's a comparison in limitation between temporal resolution and spatial resolution. So with human eyes, we can see things down to 100 micron, which is a hair size. But with the help of the microscope, we can see things down to 100 nanometer, which is basically limited by the diffraction limit, which is a physical fundamental limit. And recently, this has been broken by super resolution techniques, as you know, and this led to the chemistry Nobel Prize in 2014. On the other hand, in the time scale, with human eyes, we can see things down to 10 milliseconds. That's about the limit. But with the help of the high-speed camera, we can see things down to 1 nanosecond, and it's limited by the mechanical and electrical limits, which is technical. It's not reaching the fundamental limit yet. So probably, maybe a future Nobel Prize will go to whoever will break the temporal diffraction limit of light. So before talking about high-speed imaging, let me talk about the history of high-speed imaging. So the high-speed imaging started with this stop-motion photography in the 1870s. This is a famous Edward Muybridge horse in motion using multiple cameras. So at that time, the camera was not able to take multiple pictures. So this is the method he used to take high-speed images, multiple images in a single shot. So here, the horse cut the strings, and that trigger across the shutter, acts as a mechanical shutter to take multiple pictures so that we can take multiple pictures with different timings, and when we combine them, we can create a movie. And then later on, this motion picture photography using this Bolex 60 millimeter camera came about. And this led to the expansion of this Hollywood movies. And this is the method they used. Basically, there's a recording film, and image is recorded on this in this film, and then you shut the light and mechanically move the the film, and then and repeat the same process over and over. And because of this mechanical motion, the frame rate was limited to about 24 frames per second. And then about 25 years ago, in the 1980s, digital photography was born when these two scientists invented the CCD image sensor at Bell Labs. So because of this no mechanical shutter, we were able to record the images quickly. Here the shuttering is done electronically by turning on and off the electrical circuit. And then in 2000s, this CMOS image sensor was born, and then this type of high-speed camera with a CMOS image sensor came about, so that we are able to take this kind of high-speed pictures repetitively. So now, following this evolution of the high-speed photography, we started with mechanical shutter that led to the electrical shutter to take pictures at a higher rate. And now we are entering a new era of optical shuttering in order to take higher frame rate pictures. In order to do it, we have two requirements for high-speed imaging. One, the ability to separate the incoming continuous image encoded light into a discrete sequence of images. Two, the ability to record this discrete image sequence. So here in this talk, I want to introduce a few different kinds of high-speed imaging techniques. The first one is STEAM. It is the world's fastest camera in continuous mode. That was published back in 2009. So STEAM stands for Serial Time Encoded Amplified Imaging Microscopy. It's nearly 100 times faster than conventional CCD image sensors in terms of shutter speed and frame rate. It comes with optical image amplifier and serializer in order to overcome technical limitations in CCD and CMOS image sensor. So here's the specs. The frame rate is about 10 megaframes per second. The shutter speed is on the order of 10 picoseconds. The number of pixels is a couple hundred by a couple hundred. And optical image gain, which is the key parameter of this technique, is about 30 dB or 1,000. This is a typical schematic of STEAM. The unique feature of STEAM is spectrally structured illumination and this optical image serialization and amplification. So here, we start with a very broadband pulse laser that emits a pulse, and the spectrum of the pulse is mapped into two-dimensional rainbow pattern, and that rainbow pattern is instant onto the target for image recording, and then the light gets reflected off the target and then goes back to this special dispersor, and then the combined pulse now enter this amplified dispersive Fourier transformer that maps the spectrum of each pulse into the time domain, and at the same time, each pulse gets optically amplified. So each image, which is each pulse, which is basically image frame, is serialized and amplified simultaneously into the temporal domain and detected by the high-speed photodetector. And then by decoding the pulse, we can reconstruct the two-dimensional image. So again, the key component of this technique is this amplified dispersive Fourier transformer. The technique comes from fiber optic communication. So it uses a fiber with a large amount of dispersion. So here, the input pulse comes in, and then it propagates through this dispersive fiber. And during that process, each fiber, I mean each pulse, is evolving into its own spectrum. Also, it's getting optically amplified. So at the end, what we get is amplified and serialized image. So here's a little demonstration of this imaging, or amplified dispersive Fourier transformation. It's a serialized pulse train. So if you zoom into one of the pulses, what we see is that there's a one-to-one mapping between time and wavelengths. So here the temporal waveform matches exactly its own spectrum. This red curve is a spectrum measured by the conventional optical spectrum analyzer. So it matches the temporal waveform. So by curving or segmenting this continuous time domain waveform into a discrete bins, we can construct a series of optical spectra which are changing over time. So here, this amplified dispersive Fourier transformation achieves real-time pulse-by-pulse spectroscopy at nearly 100 megahertz scan rate, which is roughly 100,000 times faster than the conventional spectrometers. So with this steam, what kind of images can we get? There's a little comparison between CCD, CMOS, and steam images. So here's a target captured by the CCD camera. It's a single shot of a stationary target, UCLA and Hitachi. And if you take pictures with a CMOS camera, with the world's fastest CMOS camera, and these targets are moving to the right at these speeds. So 0 meter per second, 0.003 meter per second, 0.03 millisecond, 0.3 millisecond, and 3 millisecond. And because of the motion blur, at higher speed, we cannot see these patterns clearly. But with steam, we can see these objects clearly, even at 3 meter per second. One application, unique application of this steam is a steam flow cytometry. So we combine this steam camera with microfluidics and high-speed signal processing to demonstrate steam flow cytometry, which is basically high throughput image-based flow cytometry that performs non-stop real-time image recording with a record high throughput over 10,000 cells per second. So using this technique, we can detect extremely rare cancer cells in 3 milliliter of lice blood that contains 24 million white blood cells in 3 minutes. So here, most of the cells are uninteresting red blood cells and white blood cells, but occasionally we can detect rare cancer cells by imaging. By imaging, we can identify unique features of cancer cells. Another application is a high throughput image cytometry of algal cells. So algal cells are important for biofuel. So this steam flow cytometer identifies lipid for biofuel in algal cells with a throughput of 10,000 cells per second. So here the sample is Euglena cells. Euglena cells are basically algal cells that live in ponds. And these algal cells are flowing in the microfluidic device at 1 meter per second, so pretty fast. With conventional CMOS camera, we cannot detect these cells. But with steam, we can detect these cells clearly by imaging. So these black spots are actually lipid, which is important for biofilm. Another interesting imager is STAMP, which is the world's fastest camera in burst mode. So here's the difference between the continuous mode and burst mode. Continuous mode means that we can take pictures continuously at some high frame rate without a limit. The burst mode means that we can take pictures at a much higher frame rate, but with a limited number of frames. So STAMP is basically a burst mode camera, the world's fastest burst mode imager. It stands for sequentially timed all optical mapping photography, which is 100 times faster than conventional burst cameras, such as street cameras, in terms of shutter speed and frame rate. So it's equipped with optical 2D image separation, which is a unique and key technology of this STAMP. And so here are the specs. The frame rate is about 5 trillion frames per second, which is the world fastest. And the shutter speed is about 300 frames per second. And the number of pixels are 500 by 500. And the number of frames is currently limited to about 10, but it can be increased to 100. So let me show you the schematic of this STAMP. It's actually quite simple, based on temporal and spatial dispersion. So you start with an ultra-short pulse source that emits a very short pulse, a single pulse, and that's temporarily dispersed into the time domain, in this case, 6 daughter pulses by the temporal mapping device. And then 6 daughter pulses are incident onto the target, in this case, the bullet traveling through the apple. And then image encoded daughter pulses are now incident into the spatial mapping device that separates spatially these colored daughter pulses. And then these specially separated pulses are incident onto the image sensor. And then by detecting these images on the image sensor, we can reconstruct the movie. So here, let me show you an animated movie that shows the functionality of this system. So here's a big picture of this setup. So it consists of several major components. So you start with a single pulse. And this single pulse is stretched by this pulse stretcher. And then this stretched pulse is entering a pulse shaper, which consists of 2 diffraction gratings and mask. And then this pulse is separated into 6 daughter pulses, which are temporarily stretched. And then those pulses are incident onto the apple. And then image encoded pulses are now entering this special mapping device that separates those pulses specially using this unique feature called the periscope array, combined with the diffraction grating. And then these specially separated images are detected by the single CCD image array. And then these are detected images, which are separated by space, are decoded and analyzed by the computer, and then we can reconstruct the movie by combining those images into a movie. So these different colors correspond to different frames, And with this, we can do a macroscopic imaging and microscopic imaging. So here the target is basically the resolution chart. So we can clearly see the spatial pattern. The first demonstration we did was imaging of laser ablation dynamics with STAMP. So laser ablation is basically ubiquitous technology used in laser micromachining, laser surgery, and so on and so forth. So it's a very important technique, but the physics of this is not very unknown, well known. So in order to study what's going on during the laser ablation process, we ablate this glass plate with a femtosecond pulse and monitored what's going on. So here's the image sequence we got. This is a layer, and the laser pulse hits this target, and basically explosion happens, but slowly. And initially, the free electrons are generated, and then and these parts become opaque. And then a plume is generated after that. The second thing was imaging of phonons. Phonon is basically a collective lattice vibrational waves. So phononics nowadays is a hot topic of research. This conference, nanoscience and engineering, is I think covering phonons. So imaging phonon is critical for understanding the physics of semiconductor materials, and so we wanted to see the dynamics of phonons. So we use ablation pulse, femtosecond laser pulse, to create a phonon pulse in this crystalline wafer, and we monitored what's going on during that phonon generation process. So here the ablation, femtosecond laser pulse hits the target, and then a phonon pulse is created via impulsive stimulated Raman scattering. So here's the image sequence we obtained with a high frame rate of 1.23 teraframes per second with an exposure time of about 1 picosecond. So initially at 0 femtosecond, there are lots of bubbles. Basically, electronic excitation happens initially. And then later on, lattice vibrational waves appear slowly, and then eventually a phonon pulse is formed and propagating upward. And if we zoom into this part, oops, with a higher temporal resolution, here the image frame rate is about 4.4 trillion frames per second with an exposure time of nearly 700 femtoseconds. So here, basically, black and white parts corresponds to electronic motion. Of course, we cannot resolve electrons. So here, this random motion appears. And then, if you zoom into this part temporarily, we can see the dynamics of the phonon pulse propagation. Here, the what we see is a phonon pulse generation, and it's a phonon pulse propagation. So it's interesting to see that the phonon pulse is propagating at about the 1/6 of the speed of light. It's pretty fast, but with STAMP we can see that dynamics with high temporal resolution. And because we can get these images by imaging, we can perform image analysis to identify that these pulses are actually terahertz pulses with a center frequency of about 1.5 terahertz. So that's the beauty of ultrafast imaging. So far we have talked about ultrafast imaging, And because this topic is extreme imaging, we are not just addressing the needs for high-speed imaging. There is a different kind of need for ultra-slow imaging. So let me talk about ultra-slow imaging. Let me switch the topic. So earthquakes. So I'm from Japan. Japan is suffering from many earthquakes every year. So these are some of the pictures from the previous earthquakes in Japan. So unfortunately, Japan is on top of four tectonic plates. So four tectonic plates are sort of colliding with each other below Japan. So, I mean, there are lots of earthquakes here, and there are lots of earthquakes here. So if we zoom into one of these colliding areas, what's going on is basically friction. So this is the underlying mechanism of earthquakes. So this is probably something you've seen in high school textbooks, right? So the upper plate is basically on top of a lower plate, and the lower plate is sliding at very low speed. And so there's a friction going on between the upper plate and the lower plate. So if you zoom into this area, here's what we see. Basically, the two blocks, the upper block is on top of this one, and the lower block is moving with the applied force. And there's a pressure downward, and there's a normal force, right? And there's a friction. And this is something you see in high school, right? So the two laws of kinetic friction. The force of friction is directly proportional to the load. That means the frictional force is equal to the mu mg. Mu is a kinetic frictional constant. And the kinetic friction is independent of the sliding speed. So those are the two laws. And these are empirical laws and not fundamentally of physical laws. So that is because friction is not occurring between two smooth surfaces. If you zoom into this area, actually it this intersection consists of so-called asperities, lots of asperities. So they are interacting with each other. So the lower asperity is moving like this. And then there are lots of pressure going on between the asperities. So these laws of kinetic friction do not hold when the normal pressure is extremely high and the sliding speed is extremely low. This is a regime of quasi-static friction at high pressure. And this situation is quite analogous to the earthquake. There's an extremely high pressure of roughly 1 gigapascal on top of the lower plate. You can imagine that the upper plate is a heavy mass and pushing the lower mass. And the lower plate is moving at very low speed, almost 0.01 nanometer per second. And under this high pressure, the plate mostly consists of crystalline materials. And of course, in order to understand the physics of earthquakes, we want to put a probe there. But it's, of course, as you can imagine, it's very difficult to put the probe down there. So we created this apparatus to simulate the friction between the asperities of tectonic plates. So here we created a pair of silicon crystalline anvils. And basically we compress and displace. Compress the upper one and displace the lower one. And monitor what's going on with an electron microscope. So we basically perform time-lapse nanoscopy for about 30 minutes. So here's the movie. So this is upper plate and it's a upper asperity and the lower asperity. So the upper asperity is pushing the lower asperity and the lower asperity is moving towards the right. And it's, as you can see, it's happening very slowly. So this one is moving at 0.01 nanometer per second. Here's the scale bar for nanometer. And then it's, you know, this junction between the asperity is being stretched, and then eventually it will break. Okay. So what is going on here? So basically what's going on is the so-called superplasticity. Superplasticity is basically the process of decrystallization, atomic diffusion, and plastic deformation. So these black and white images are basically the movie images we got from the time-lapse nanoscope. And these colorful ones are basically the simulation results. So basically, this pair of crystalline anvils are colliding with each other, and that creates amorphous region. The yellow one is amorphous layer, and then that dissipates some energy. And when the lower plate is moving toward the right, and then this amorphous layer dissipates the energy accumulated at the intersection. So, yeah, sorry. So there's a good agreement between experiment and simulation. So this leads to the conclusion that superplasticity is occurring. And this plasticity is induced by decrystallization, plastic deformation, and atomic diffusion at the asperity-asperity interface. So this has a unique indication that this superplasticity is very hard to pronounce. Superplasticity helps reduce the chance of catastrophic destruction by dissipating the energy accumulated at the asperity-asperity interface. So in order to understand this, basically at the same shear strain, the shear stress is smaller if you have amorphous sandwich structure. This, if there's an amorphous layer in between crystalline layers. So that high pressure actually helps dissipate the energy. So this indicates that by controlling the pressure of the upper layer onto the lower layer, we can probably control the magnitude of the earthquakes. Like, for example, we can produce multiple magnitude 3 earthquakes instead of a single magnitude 9 earthquake. The same energy dissipation, but for human beings, this is a better condition. I'm not sure how we can control the pressure onto the lower plate, but physically this sounds okay. Okay, so it was about time to finish. So to summarize, basically I talked about extreme imaging on both the ultrafast and ultraslow timescales. So extreme imaging helps us understand the underlying laws of nature and exploit new applications. So anything much faster or much slower than the human timescale is difficult to study due to the lack of imaging tools. So opportunities exist for the development of and new imaging methods that can open up new windows onto science, industry, and medicine. So this is a good message for students who basically want to do new science or open up new windows onto new applications. So finally, I'd like to acknowledge my group members at the University of Tokyo, lots of students from many countries. About 50% of them are Japanese, and the rest are Chinese, Indian, Indonesian, and so on and so forth, mostly from Asia. And also, I'd like to acknowledge my funding agencies. Thank you very much for listening.